I, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC, welcome you all in our continuum with the webinars, with the speakers who can give us insights on different perspectives of law. On the first brush, the topic for today, rejection and return of the plaint, simpliciter looks as if there's not much to speak and much to learn. It's very, very simple. It's as good as one on the first brush can feel that you can reject the topic itself. It's so simple to understand. But once you examine it as a lawyer and as a student of law, one finds that there's a lot to be learned within the same topic. As they say, the more you study, the more you understand that what are the deeper contours which are to be understood. And for this, we have requested Mr. Srinath Sridharan to give their insights. And when we requested him, he acceded to that. And when we were discussing with him, he said, it's a quite a vast subject. And then we also realized, yes, it is. And that's to say the difference between a lawyer and a different lawyer who especially been a gold medalist and studied abroad would tell the the subtle differences which one should understand for the perspective of rejection and return of the plaint. Those who have been connected with him know it very well that their law firm of HSB is a reputed law firm. People look upon him. And after we connected him, I came to know that he was quite engaged with the professional commitments, but at the same time, and when I was seeing and it was written that as and when he gets the time, he also takes the classes in the School of Excellence Law Chennai. But this time it was quite different. That we did not see that as and when he gets the time, we just requested him and saw that you have to create the time for us. Because the times having a perspective of law for a person who can give actually the deeper roots of law is always understandable and appreciable, which goes deeper inside to the mind to understand for all times to come. Without taking much time, I will request Mr. Srinath Sridharan to give the insights to the topic. Over to you, Srinath, and thank you for accepting our invite.
Thanks, Vikas. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you. Now, the topic, as Vikas mentioned, is deceptive. It starts off seeming to be just two rules in Order 7, but you will find that the volume of litigation that has stemmed from these two rules will really tell you, A, that it's a powerful tool for all of us practitioners to use, and it is something which is going to be increasingly prevalent as the days go by. So let's start off. I should add one more thing. Initially, I had thought we would do it with PowerPoint, but Vikas, in his usual style, said that, look, we want to see you speak. We don't want to see you read a PowerPoint. And so Vikas, you're right. So let's start off. What is a civil suit? How is it commenced? A civil suit is commenced by the presentation of a plaint. Now, what is the presentation of a plaint? The presentation of a plaint is validly done when two things are fulfilled. First, the plaint must be seeking a relief of a civil nature. And B, it must be presented before a court of competent jurisdiction. If both of these are fulfilled, a civil action commences. Mm. Now, Order 7, Rule 10, and Order 7, Rule 11 deal with the return of a plaint and the rejection of a plaint, respectively. I'm going to take up Order 7, Rule 11 first, before we come to 7-10. And the reason is that 7-11 is what I expect to see the most litigation in the days to come. And therefore, it is that which is of greater importance than 7-10. Not to say that 7-10 doesn't have its uses, it does. But let's take 7-11 first. Order 7, Rule 11 speaks of six circumstances in which a plaint can be rejected. 11A speaks of rejection of a plaint where the plaint fails to disclose a cause of action. B is a case where the suit is undervalued and the court gives the plaintiff a chance to fix it and he doesn't do it. C again is something which is fairly minor. It speaks of failure to affix the proper court fee. D is very important. D speaks of rejection of a plaint where the plaint appears on the face of it to be barred by any law. Then you have E and F, which are, to me, they shouldn't be there at all. It was introduced by the 2002 amendment to the CPC, and it speaks of rejection of a plaint for failure to file copies of the plaint along with the main plaint. And it seems to me to be more of a clerical requirement. And even the Supreme Court of India, in the case of Salem Bar Association versus Union of India, held that these last two subrules, that is 711E and 711F, are purely procedural, and the courts will not reject the plaint directly for breach of these two. So I'm going to disregard 711E and F because, frankly, they are not of much importance. We will focus on A and D. Now, before we take up either A or D, we must first note no discussion on rejection of plaint would be complete without us first going through Justice V.R. Krishnaya's judgment in the case of Arivanandam versus Satyapal, which is AR 1977, Supreme Court 2421. The facts of this case are important because all of us practitioners would have seen cases like this at some point of time or the other. So what happened in this case is there was a poor gentleman called Satyapal who owned a very valuable property in the city of Bangalore. He had let it out to one gentleman whose name doesn't come out in the record. And like all landlords, he has difficulties with his tenant. And finally, he initiates an action, a civil action, to evict the tenant. Now, the tenant obviously defends it. Eviction is ordered. He files appeal. Appeal is dismissed. He files a revision in the High Court. The revision is also dismissed. This goes for about 8 years. Immediately after the eviction decree is passed, what happens next? And it's something which we all know. The son, Arivanandam, he files a civil suit to declare that the eviction decree obtained against the father is null and void. There again, the suit starts. He gets injunction, appeal, goes up to the High Court. Again, in the High Court, the High Court confirms this. Thereafter, what happens? Thereafter, the son files a fresh suit, suppressing the earlier suit, again saying that the eviction decree is null and void, and again asks for an injunction restraining the enforcement of the eviction decree. He also obtains an ex parte injunction. The landlord, after so many years, again goes back to the judge, tells the judge that, judge, you've been deceived and misrepresented, and you've granted the injunction. So the civil judge junior in Bangalore, he dismisses the injunction application. The matter goes on revision to the High Court. In the High Court, it comes back before the same judge who decided the earlier round of litigation. And the son then files a petition asking the judge to recuse himself from the case. The judge thinks about it and then says, no, I'm not going to recuse myself. And he dismisses the revision. The matter goes on appeal to the Supreme Court, and it comes before Justice Krishnayar. So there, Justice Krishnayar uses language which I think is absolutely fundamental to an understanding of what Order 7, Rule 11 is about. And he says, and I'm going to read from the judgment, and I would encourage you all to read it. It is something which you can cite, because every court after 1977 Supreme Court follows it. And I have never seen a single judgment doubting it or dissenting from it. So Justice Krishnayar says, the learned munsif, that is the civil junior judge, must remember that if on a meaningful not formal, reading of the plaint, it is manifestly vexatious and meritless. In the sense of not disclosing a clear right to sue, he should exercise his power under Order 7, Rule 11, CPC, taking care to see the ground mentioned therein is fulfilled. And if clever drafting has created the illusion of a cause of action, he must nip it in the bud at the first hearing by examining the party. And then he says, an activist judge is the answer to irresponsible lawsuits, and the trial court should ensure that bogus litigation is shot down at the earliest stage. Therefore, for the first time, in Arivanandam versus Satyapal, the Supreme Court said that Order 7, Rule 11 is not discretionary. It is mandatory. And in fact, if you read 7-11, you see it uses the word shall. Therefore, if the ingredients in 7-11A or 7-11D are in existence, the court must exercise its power. So after Arivanandam Satyapal, you start seeing judges, you know, because litigation is the curse of India. And all over India, and I say this without any fear of contradiction, litigations go on for so many years that the litigants lose faith in the system and they start seeking other remedies. So it is the responsibility of all of us as lawyers and also the judges as well to ensure that litigations are given a finality quickly. Litigants will accept a result, you know, right or wrong. Indians are very philosophical. They will understand if the judge has disagreed with them on merits. But nobody can understand, you know, a case going on for 20 years, 30 years, third round, fourth round. Therefore, Arivanandam Satyapal is the first case, and we all must know it before we venture into any discussion on 7-11. There is one more aspect I want to talk about before we start taking up the ingredients. And that is that what are the principles to be exercised, to be kept in mind while considering 7-11? There are two principles. Again, these are not, I'm not going into stuff where the courts have taken contra views. This is stuff which the courts are unanimous about. First, what is the material that you can go through while deciding whether a plaint is to be rejected or not? The earlier strict view was that you should look at the plaint and plaint alone and nothing else. But over the last 20, 25 years, the Supreme Court has now relaxed it a little bit and says you can look at the plaint and the documents filed with the plaint. You must look at these two and see if on the basis of these two, if you can come to the conclusion that either 711A is available or 711D is available, then you must exercise the power. I will give the list of all case laws to Vikas after this. So you don't need to worry about it. There are a bunch of judgments I'm going to refer to in the course of this talk. I will give the full list to Vikas and you can collect it from him. So now we come to 711A. 711A speaks of when the plaint fails to disclose a cause of action. What is cause of action? The term cause of action has been defined several times over the years. The best definition you will find is in a case called ABC Laminart, which is AR 1989 Supreme Court, I think 1247 or 1274. The SEC, I don't remember. So in ABC Laminart, the Supreme Court says that cause of action is the entire bundle of facts which need to be pleaded and, if proved, will entitle the plaintiff to the relief which he or she claims. So it's the entire bundle of facts which needs to be proved before the court to get the relief you want. Now, just let's talk about a specific case where this issue was actually considered. This is a case called Church of South India versus Punniyamman Education Trust, and I will give you the citation. It is a 2012 Supreme Court. I'm sorry, I don't have the citation. One of you can look it up. It is Church of South India versus Ponniyamman Education Trust. The facts are as follows. So the Church of South India Educational Society owned a very large piece of land. And they entered into an agreement with one particular, another educational trust, and agreed to sell the property to them. In the meanwhile, they also entered into a transfer deed with this Ponniyamman Educational Trust. Now, thereafter, there seems to have been some dispute between Church of South India and the person with whom they entered an agreement of sale. And so Church of South India filed a suit against the agreement holder for a declaration the agreement is null and void, and also sought for a permanent injunction against the Ponniyamman Trust, with whom the transaction was not related at all. And it attempted to get a relief against Ponniyamman. Now, at this stage, Ponniyamman rushed to court, filed an Order 7 Rule 11 application saying that there is no privity between us and the Church of South India as far as this particular agreement is concerned. And there's nothing in the plaint about us excepting in the prayer. Now, in that rejection application, they did not make the original agreement holder a party. So the High Court of Madras, in that case, it dismissed the Order 7 Rule 11 application, saying that one, the question as to whether or not there is privity between Ponniyamman and Church of South India is a matter, it's a question of fact to be gone into only in the course of trial. It also said that the other defendant was not made a party to the Order 7 Rule 11 application, and that therefore the Order 7 Rule 11 application cannot be decided at the instance of one defendant alone. Now, as against that decision, the matter went on appeal to the division bench. The division bench reversed. The matter went to the Supreme Court. In the Supreme Court of India, their lordships, Justice Sadashivam and Chellameswar, gave the judgment. They held the following principles. They said that you need to go through the plaint meaningfully. So they take inspiration from Justice Krishnayar in Arivanandam and say that you need to go through the plaint meaningfully. When you go through the plaint, you find that there is nothing on the face of it against Ponniyamman. First. Second, and this is something where you will find there are different views. They say that a rejection of plaint application can be entertained at the instance of one defendant. And it's not necessary that all the defendants must seek rejection of plaint. And therefore, they went ahead and held that the plaint was liable to be rejected. So you have this principle where the Supreme Court says that whether there's a cause of action or not is not necessarily a question of fact to be gone into at trial each and every time. There are cases where you can go through the plaint, and if on the face of it you find there's no nexus between the facts pleaded and the prayers sought, and even if the prayer is as against one party alone, the court has the power to reject the plaint. Then, when we move on from Church of Christ, there is one more judgment of the Supreme Court called Jogeshwari Devi versus Shatrughan Ram, which is 2007, volume 15, SEC, page 52. That was a case where the plaint was not very well drafted. There was the cause of action was not spelt out clearly against one of the defendants, very similar to Church of South India. However, if one was to read between the lines and also the plain documents, you could understand that it was a case of defective drafting and that actually you could make out a cause of action. So that was a case where the Supreme Court said that you are not entitled to seek rejection under 711A where it is possible to make out a cause of action. So that is the contra view. Then we come to the next case on the issue of cause of action. This is a very interesting one. This is the case of ITC versus Debts Recovery Appellate Tribunal. It's a 1998 Supreme Court judgment. I don't have the citation of 1998 Volume 2 SEC page 70. And this is a case where a particular bank had issued a letter of credit favoring ITC, and the letter of credit was required to secure the supply of certain goods by a supplier to ITC, that is the Indian Tobacco Company. And so under the terms of the LC, ITC went ahead and made a claim, and the money was paid by the bank to ITC. Now, after some time, the bank in question found that it was not able to recover the dues from the person, from its customer at whose request it had issued the LC. Therefore, it filed a suit against its customer and also made ITC a party, saying that we paid the money to you by mistake under the LC. Therefore, please give the money back. Now, this case got transferred after suit was filed in 1985. In 1993, the debts recovery tribunals were constituted. The suit was transferred to the DRT. The DRT passed a one-line order. Cause of action is a question of fact. Dismissed. The matter went to the DRAT. It was dismissed. The matter went to the High Court. It was dismissed. It finally reached the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said that your plea, that is the bank's plea, namely that they have been misled into paying money under an LC, is something which is not permitted under the law applicable to LCs. A letter of credit can be nullified only in cases of fraud. And the Supreme Court held that since the allegations in the plaint did not make out any case of fraud, there was no cause of action as against ITC. And therefore, the plaint was rejected again as against one of the defendants. So in ITC, which is 1998 Volume 2 SEC page 70, you find a very interesting example of a case where the power of rejection has been exercised against one of the defendants in respect of one of the claims in a suit. Now, the reason this is important is you will find that there are judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court which say that a plaint can't be rejected in part. It must either be rejected in whole or not at all. But when you read ITC, the ITC judgment, and when you compare it with the later judgments which said that you cannot reject a plaint in part, the conclusion that you can draw is if the plaint can be rejected in part against a defendant, then Order 7, Rule 11 is maintainable. Therefore, if a plaint fails to disclose a cause of action against one of the defendants, and if the objection raised by that defendant has the effect of getting the suit dismissed as a whole against him or her, then in such a case, the power will be exercised under Order 7, Rule 11 to have the plaint rejected as against that defendant, and the suit will be dismissed as a whole against him. Then the next point we come to is how is this power under Order 7, Rule 11A, or even in some cases 11D, how is it to be exercised? Is it necessary for a defendant to apply to the court, or can the court do it on its own power? So in the case of Abdul Ghafoor, AR 2009 Supreme Court page 413, the Supreme Court recognizes that there are three ways in which an objection, that is an objection as to the fact that a plaint is liable to be rejected, can be raised. First, on a formal application. So here the defendant files an application at 7-11, sets out all the facts, and invites the court to pass an order of rejection. The second, the Supreme Court says that the court can also do it suo motu. The court is not powerless. So for example, if in a particular case, the court finds that a suit is being instituted for ulterior motive, then the court can, if it finds that it is barred by law, for example, the court can itself reject the plaintiff. I will give examples when I come to 711D. The third example, which the Supreme Court gave, is something called a demurrer. What is a demurrer? A demurrer is where the counsel for the defendant, without filing a formal application, makes an oral objection in court saying that, please decide the issue of maintainability first before you proceed to hear the suit. So therefore, there are three ways by which the power under 711 can be invited: on a formal application, by the court itself, or by a defendant, merely by demurrer. Then we come to 711B. I'll just touch on 711B and 711C before we move on to the more important one, which is 711D. So in 711B, the court says that if there is an undervaluation of a suit, then the court has the power to reject the plaintiff. Now, there are a few scenarios where you will find that this power is very interesting. And all of you as busy practitioners will certainly be aware that when you are filing a suit, you have a choice of which court to go to. So if you're filing an injunction suit, you typically, the valuation is notional. What does notional mean? It means that the learned counsel who's filing the plaint can adopt the valuation which appears to the practitioner to be correct and proper in the facts of the case. Now, what if a party values the case deliberately so as to bring it before a particular court? What happens? Supreme Court in 1992, Volume 1, SEC, page 731, said that where the valuation is done with ulterior motive, the power can be exercised under 711B. We will also touch upon this when we come to return of plaint, because there is something very interesting there, and it's a case which I argued. So we will talk about this further. But just remember that 710B is almost always going to be a case which results in return of the plaint, excepting the rarest of rare cases like the one which I mentioned, where the defendant goes before the judge saying that, listen, he is deliberately undervaluing it for the purpose of, let's say, forum shopping, or to take the court to a different jurisdiction. In those cases, 710B will be invoked. 710C is a case of a failure to pay court fee. It almost never happens. The court gives time, and if the plaintiff doesn't pay the court fee by the time, 710C will be invoked. Then we come to 711D, which is a plaintiff is to be rejected when it is barred by any law. Now, what is a bar under law? There are two kinds of bars. You have an implied bar and an express bar. An express bar is there when you have a particular statute which has a section which says, for example, jurisdiction of civil courts is barred in respect of action taken or purporting to be taken under this act. So all the sales tax laws, income tax act, the Securitization Act, all these acts have a bar of civil court jurisdiction clause. So that is an express bar. You also have laws which create an implied bar. What is an implied bar? An implied bar exists where a statute provides a special right and a special hierarchy of tribunals or forum in which that right can be addressed. Now, the best examples of these would be the electricity laws and the property tax laws. So both with respect to electricity charges and with respect to property tax, the citizen has a right to challenge the levy of electricity charges or property tax before a specific forum under those statutes. You have an appeal under the statutes, you have a further revision, and so on. So in cases like these, the courts have held that it is a case of an implied bar and the civil court will not have jurisdiction. So let us now go to the principles governing Order 7, Rule 11D. The first principle is you cannot look into the written statement for determining whether a suit is barred or not. You must look only at the plaint and, of course, the plaint documents. And that is laid down in XFAR versus UPharma, which is AR 2004, Supreme Court 1682. Then, once you have, you must read the plaint, and as Justice Krishna says, you must read the plaint in a meaningful manner and then see if there is a bar under a statute. Let us talk now about the most famous case involving an express bar, which is Jagdish versus Hiralal, which is a case involving a bar under the Securitization Act. So in Jagdish versus Hiralal, the borrower who was facing action from the bank under Securitization Act filed a suit for a declaration that the mortgage in favor of the bank was bad. Now, the courts, the civil courts took the view that as to whether or not a person has a full title or an encumbered title is a civil question. It can be determined by the civil courts. But the Honorable Supreme Court on appeal said that when you look at Section 34 of the Securitization Act, it says that any question which the tribunals under this act are competent to determine must be determined by these tribunals alone and not by any civil court. So therefore, the Supreme Court says the test is, can you obtain a remedy under the special statute? Obtain a remedy, then the civil court's jurisdiction is barred. If you can't obtain a remedy, then the civil court still has jurisdiction. There is yet another line of cases. The high courts have taken different views. The matters yet to reach the Supreme Court. And those are cases where, for example, there is an assignment of a debt, whether it's under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code or under the Securitization Act, whether the assignment can be questioned before the civil court or not, and that the Kerala High Court and Madras High Court have held that you can. Bombay and Calcutta have said that civil court jurisdiction is barred. So these are instances where the civil court's jurisdiction is expressly barred. Now let's talk about the implied bar. Implied bar, the best example is the case of Premier Automobiles versus, I'll give the case law, Premier Automobiles versus Kamlekar Shantaram, 1975 Supreme Court 2238. So that was a case where the workman sought a declaration before the civil court that a particular action sought to be taken by the management against the workman was invalid. Now, there is no bar of civil court jurisdiction anywhere under the Industrial Disputes Act. However, the Honorable Supreme Court in Premier Automobiles laid down the law that where a right is conferred under a statute, so the right not to be retrenched, the right not to be laid off, this is a special right. Where a right is created in a statute and special tribunals are formed where these rights can be redressed, then the civil court's jurisdiction is impliedly barred. So therefore, you can invoke 711D not only when there is an express bar, but also where there's an implied bar. Now we come to the most hotly contested aspect of 711D. And all of you are going to get tons of cases in this. So we must be prepared. And in this, Supreme Court has said opposite things so many times that there is no way of analyzing what Honorable Supreme Court means. So the question is, if a suit is filed after the period of limitation, is it barred by the law of limitation under 711D or not? So the first case where the Supreme Court expressly said limitation is a mixed question of law and fact, you cannot invoke it at the stage of Order 7, Rule 11D, is a judgment called as Popat Kotecha versus State Bank of India Association. So in Popat Kotecha, the Supreme Court has said that on the facts of that case, the question was a lease had been granted, a renewal took place in the year 1999. Certain monies were payable pursuant to the renewal. And the question was whether, and the suit was filed 6 years after that. The question was whether the suit for specific performance of the renewal clause could be entertained more than 3 years after the last renewal. So the Honorable Supreme Court said that 6 years have gone by, but the question as to whether or not there had been a denial of the right to performance is a mixed question of law and fact. Therefore, we are not permitting it to be raised. We are not permitting limitation to be raised as a ground of bar under Order 7, Rule 11D. The exact opposite view was taken in a case called Hardesh Ores, H-A-R-D-E-S-H, Hardesh Ores. That's a 2005 judgment, which went for the Bombay High Court. It was argued by Mr. Fali Nariman, Mr. Soli Sorabji, Mr. Mukul Rohatgi. All the great seniors argued this case. So this was a case where two parties had entered into a mining agreement to extract minerals. And thereafter, that mining came to be banned because of the Honorable Supreme Court's directions in another famous case called as Godavarman Tirumalpad. And that happened in 1996. A suit was filed nearly 6 years later, claiming some rights under the mine sharing agreement. Now, the Honorable Bombay High Court took the view that when the rights had crystallized on a particular date, in this case it was 2001, the suit could not have been, 1991, the suit could not have been filed in the year 1996 because it was barred by time. I mean, the facts are very similar to Popat Kotecha. However, in this case, Honorable Supreme Court took the view that when the time bar is very obvious on the face of it, you can dismiss the suit on the ground of limitation. A similar view has been taken by Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Raghavendra Sharan, which is AR 2019, Supreme Court 1430. And Honorable Supreme Court has also taken the opposite view, that is, that limitation is a mixed question of law and fact, in the case of Chotan Ben versus Kirithbhai, which is 2018, Volume 6, SEC, page 422. So this area as to whether the bar of the law of limitation creates a right to have a plaint rejected under Order 7, Rule 11 is something which requires a lot of thought and analysis. Let us take, for example, the case of Raghavendra Sharan, which is 2019 Supreme Court 1430. In that case, there was a right created under an instrument, and what the party did was he filed a suit nearly 6 years after the instrument without referring to the instrument. So he said he was ignoring it and filing the suit. The Honorable Supreme Court said that by omitting to seek a relief, which is time barred, and simply seeking the consequential relief, you cannot escape the bar of limitation. And it's a case where we must invoke Order 7, Rule 11, Subrule D. So you can see So this is a case where the Honorable Supreme Court went far beyond the plaint and invoked 711D. Whereas you have Popat Kotecha on the other hand, where Honorable Supreme Court lays down virtually as a blanket law that limitation is mixed question of law and fact. So this is, as I said at the commencement of this point, this is an area where I see a room for a great deal of litigation, and all of us as practitioners must be well equipped with the judgments both for and against both sides of the argument in relation to this point. Like I said, I'm not going to touch upon 711E and F at all because I think they are quite unimportant. Now, if a plaint is rejected, what is the party's remedy? Under section 2, subsection 2 of the CPC, the word decree is defined, and the word decree includes an order rejecting a plaint. Therefore, an order of a court rejecting a plaint is a deemed decree under section 2.2, and only a regular appeal lies. But if, on the other hand, the court dismisses your application to reject the plaint, what remedy do you have? Earlier, we used to file revisions under section 115 CPC, but now you can only file a revision under article 227 after the 2002 amendment, and only if your revision falls within the norms laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in Surya Chandra Rai's case, which is 2003 Supreme Court. So this concludes Order 7, Rule 11. I will now very quickly run through Order 7, Rule 10. I realize I'm hitting the end of my time limit, so I'll be quick on this. So Order 7, Rule 10 permits a court in which a suit has been improperly filed to return the same for presentation to a proper court. So what does the legislature mean when they say an improper court? A court may be improper for two reasons. First, on account of pecuniary jurisdiction, or on account of territorial jurisdiction. So for instance, if I was to file a suit in Chennai in respect of a property in Jalandhar, and I was to file a suit for injunction, for example, the court in Chennai would be an improper court, and the court would return the plaint for the purpose of enabling me to present it in the proper court in Jalandhar. The other thing is pecuniary. So as to what is the amount of money which enables you to approach a particular court varies from state to state. And so that will depend upon what is the law which fixes the pecuniary jurisdiction in your state, which will determine which is the proper court. Now, there's one important thing to remember here. If you file a suit of a lower valuation in a superior court, it is not a case of lack of jurisdiction. But if you file a suit of a higher valuation before a junior judge who doesn't have that power, then it's a case of no jurisdiction. So while in the first case where you file the low value suit in the superior court, the superior judge can, if he wants, return the plaint sending you to the lower court, or the superior judge can hear it himself. But if you file a high value suit in a court with a junior judge, the junior judge has to return the plaint to you to enable you to approach the proper court. Then we come to one very important aspect of a return of plaint. Now, let's say in the place where I come from, which is the state of Tamil Nadu, the junior civil judges can hear suits of a value up to, for example, 1 lakh rupees. So let's say that I file a suit against a person for 90,000. And during the while the suit is pending, I realize that I've forgotten to include interest claim. And so I amend my plaint, raising it from 90,000 to, let's say, 1.5 lakhs. Now, would the junior judge have the jurisdiction to hear my amendment application or not? Now, this is something which was litigated extensively, but now unanimously all the high courts in the country have held that in a case where a plaint is being amended to beyond the jurisdiction of a court, then the court has the power to allow the amendment. The only consequence is, after allowing the amendment, it must exercise powers under Order 7, Rule 10 and give the plaint back. So it's the court has the power to grant amendment, and then it must exercise the power under 7 Rule 10. Then we come to the interesting aspect of 7 Rule 10. And this is, like I said, this is a case which I actually argued. So there was a suit which was pending before the senior civil judge in a matter which was arguing. So the value was between 1 and 5 lakhs. And the senior judge had made it very clear that he was not in favor of what the plaintiff was arguing. So at some point of time, he amended the plaint, notionally increasing the value from, I think it was 3 lakhs, he increased it to 10 lakhs. So the case would go before the district judge. So the question which then arose is, can a person amend the valuation of plaint purely for the purpose of avoiding an inconvenient court, purely for choosing a specific court? And there the Honorable Delhi High Court and the Honorable Madras High Court have both held, you cannot permit an amendment just to shift the valuation out of a court for the purpose of forum shopping or to avoid inconvenient judges. And therefore, that is a case where the amendment was refused and consequently return of plaint was also refused. So that's the only last aspect on return of plaint is limitation. Now, the court which returns the plaint will fix the time within which you must represent the plaint. And if the plaint is represented within that time, then the suit is deemed to be presented within time. All of you should also take a look at Section 14 of the Limitation Act, which enables for extension of limitation in such cases. So both in the case of Order 7 Rule 10 and 7 Rule 11, if a fresh suit is permitted, then limitation will not be a problem because Section 14 Limitation Act will permit it. This concludes 710. The only point which remains to be seen is what is the remedy. In the case of rejection of plaint, you have an regular appeal. However, in the case of return of plaint, Order 43 Rule 1 Subrule A permits an appeal, a miscellaneous appeal. So this concludes Order 7 Rule 10 and Order 7 Rule 11. I think I've exceeded my time by about 12 minutes. Thank you so much, Vikas. Are there any questions, Vikas?
Thank you, Srinath. As I was surprised that you would explain in a subtle manner, it was actually weaved out in a nice manner that ultimately what has been woven out is a nice piece to be actually put upon. Before we take the questions on the platform, Mr. Ramnath wishes to ask something. We are unmuting him. Ramnath.
Mr. Very good.
You have muted yourself. Just Mr. Ramnath, just hold on. Mr. Srinath has to unmute himself. Yes. Yes, Ramnath ji, you can ask.
Sir, very good evening. This is Ramnath, your junior, sir.
Good evening, Ramnath. Pleasure to see you.
Yes, sir. Very nice to see you, sir. Sir, I have a doubt. Sir, we filed an execution application before Tambram Court for executing of an award. For the total claim amount in the award is 1,30,000 rupees, which is coming under the subcourt Tambram, which has jurisdiction from 1 lakh to 10 lakhs. Now, they have returned the EP with an endorsement saying that the actual award amount is 90,000 and the remaining amount is interest. So this has to be returned and represented before the appropriate court at Munsif level, which has jurisdiction to 1 lakh. When I represented it before the district munsif said the total claim is 1,15,000. So I cannot take up beyond my jurisdiction. It has to be presented before the appropriate court. What has to be done, sir?
It's very unfortunate when courts play volleyball with the litigants. So in this case, what you have to look at, you have to look at the decree. If the decree awards only the principal amount, okay, and does not quantify the due as on the date of decree, then some courts do take the view that you must look at the amount specified in the decree which has been determined for the purpose of determining the jurisdiction. But however, if the court says that, you know, with interest till date and future interest at 6%, then clearly in this case, the court which returned your EP first was wrong. And the learned junior civil judge who later on asked you to go to the Superior Court, he was right.
Thank you, sir.
This is father of a plaintiff inherited the same. After the demise of the plaintiff's father, plaintiff inherited the same. Plaintiff's sisters relinquished their rights to plaintiff. Regarding earlier suit proceedings was also enlightened in the plaintiff. Defendants filed a written statement by denying the title of the plaintiffs and asserting their title based on various title deeds. Then plaintiff was examined as PW1. Exhibits were also marked. The case was posted for cross-examination. But the defendants came with an application for rejection of the plaint that in earlier suit itself, the defendants denied their title of plaintiffs and his father. Hence, this suit is barred by limitation as per Article 58A. I will read it again because...
No, I think it's clear as to what the question is. So, I think subject to correction that in this case, Order 7, Rule 11 won't lie for two reasons. One is, I think from your question, I don't know what the court decided in the earlier suit about the merits of the denial of title. If the earlier proceedings ended with the denial of title being upheld, then clearly the later suit is barred. But it would be barred not only on the ground of limitation, but probably also on the ground of res judicata. If, on the other hand, the earlier suit is still pending, or if the denial of title has been rejected, then it's a question of fact which will need to be deemed and proved.
Just hold on. Because you explained so elucidatedly, then I always say there are only two occasions when the questions don't come. Either you explain it very elucidatedly or either you people have not understood it. But the fact that the participants are continuing glued with the screen, so it shows that they have actually understood it. So you fall on the other side where people have understood it and then the question is, one is on the Facebook, I've just read it, since we are live on the Facebook. Can a suit be filed for eviction based on an order passed in a labor court? Can we file a rejection of the plaint when cause of action is based on the order of a tribunal court?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Can a suit be filed for eviction based on an order passed in a labor court? Can we file rejection of the plaint when cause of action is based on the order of a tribunal? I will ask her because labor court and eviction. So lastly, you will have to, if you have been able to gather it, because it says, can a suit be filed for eviction based on an order passed in the labor court? And can we file a rejection of the plaint when call of action is based on an order of a tribunal court?
Now, okay, this it will depend largely on whether you accept that the earlier proceedings before the tribunal are with jurisdiction or if the jurisdiction is contested. If the tribunal had jurisdiction, okay, then Section 11 explanation, I think one or two, says that even a court of limited jurisdiction will operate as res judicata with respect to matters within its jurisdiction. So if a labor, so in your case, if for example, it was a case of employee accommodation, and the dismissal of the employee had been upheld in the labor court, then a consequential action for eviction will certainly lie. But like I said, it depends on the facts of the case. It will be a bar for a later suit, provided the tribunal in question is a court of limited jurisdiction, having jurisdiction on the facts in controversy.
Yes. It is in case... in a case to declare a registered deed as null and void due to undue influence, due to influence and coercion. Defendant files an IA under section under Order 7, Rule 11B. During the IA, found plaintiff has not asked for any constitutional relief and bare declaration is not permitted as per Section 34 of the Relief Act. Judge has allowed IA under Order 7, Rule 11B and rejected the plate. What is your take whether it can be the plaint can be rejected on this ground? The question is around.
It's a good. See, you have two things here. One is 711B, which this probably won't come in 711B. This will be covered by 711D because, as you rightly said, Section 34 explanation of specifically fact 1963 says that where you can seek a consequential relief but omit to do so, a bare declaration is barred. So this is a question. Your IA would fall under 711D, but the question is, you know, so for example, there are very few suits where a bare declaration will lie. Excepting in case like a declaration that an adoption is valid, for example. But barring that, it looks like if the judge had mentioned 711D, it will be right. But just by quoting the wrong provision of law, I don't think it will vitiate the order. A suit for bare declaration is barred under the specific leave act.
But in some cases, the courts have also held that a wrong nomenclature will not do. You have to understand the what is the nitty-gritty and what is the entire substance.
Correct.
Absolutely. Let's assume even if a show cause notice, there are judgments to that effect which say that if the wrong provision has been mentioned in the show cause notice itself, that would not frustrate the show cause notice. Only on the wrong mentioning of the provision, you have to see the substance.
Absolutely, absolutely.
This is on the Facebook by Krishna Kumar Mishra. Can plaintiff bring amendment to bring cause of action to defeat the application under Order 7, Rule 11 of the moved by the defendant?
I missed the question. Can you repeat that?
Can the plaintiff bring an amendment to bring cause of action to defeat the application under Order 7, Rule 11 of the defendant?
Great question. It happens all the time. I guess it depends on the nature of amendment. So if for example, you are pleading that there is no cause of action and the amendment, you know, gives the linking cause of action without fundamentally altering the suit, the amendment will be permitted. Okay. When will an amendment not be permitted? Now, if for example, I'll give you a case which actually I argued. So this is a case where it was a family where there were brothers and sisters. The sisters had released all their rights in an earlier family partition of the year 1973. Now, one of the sisters' children filed a suit in the year 2019 for partition, claiming that the mother has a share under this newly amended Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act. Now, so we raised an objection saying that unless you set aside the release deed executed by your mother, you are not entitled to partition. And in view of my rejection application, he filed a petition to amend the plaint to bring in a new relief of declaration. And so the amendment was allowed by the trial court. We won in the high court. And on appeal, their lordships, Justice Abdul Nazir and I think Justice Arun Mishra, they confirmed. So that is a case where they said you can't bring in an amendment purely for the purpose of filling up the lacunae pointed out in the Order 7, Rule 11.
Okay. This is. So what is your opinion on the judgment of Radha Krishnan versus Wali Muhammad case?
I'm so sorry. If you can give the citation, I can. Which case is this?
I'll also check it out, or I will ask Sankaran to explain that, and I would also reflect. This is by Lal Tejwani. If a suit is returned by the district court for applying in the right jurisdiction, in this case to the family court, what is the procedure? Does the court transfer the suit to a new jurisdiction, or plaintiff has to take complaint and file it again in this family court. In this case, it's a case of custody of the child under the guardians of order.
This again, it's a very interesting question. There were two views earlier by the Honorable Supreme Court. One was that the Supreme Court, in the case of Joginder Tulsi versus S.L. Bhatia, 1997, Volume 1, SCC, page 502, the Supreme Court took the view that when a plaint is returned for presenting to a proper court, then the new court starts the case from wherever, whichever stage it was left by the returning court. In ONGC versus Modern Construction, that is 2014, 1 SEC 648, the Supreme Court took the contrary view and said that when a suit is returned for presentation to proper court, the new court has to start the suit from scratch. But since both these judgments were given by equal benches, it was referred to a larger bench, the larger bench judgment came only 2 weeks ago. It's called EXL versus Frank Finn. And they've held that ONGC Modern Construction is the correct view. So when once the plaint is returned, you have to start from zero. This is the larger bench judgment, which came just, like I said, 5th of August. So Mr. Lal Tejwani, your question is very timely. And it shows that, you know, the law is marching and we have to march with the law.
This is by, in the case of amendment of the plaint, can amended plaintiff be charged? Can the plaintiff be charged by fine in intention to representing the facts where he missed to mention one party in the defendant's list in the property case?
I'm assuming, Mr. Sharma, that yours is a case where the amendment was to add a party. If that is the case, because that's what then your question.
He says yes.
If the plaintiff forgets to add a party and then tries to bring in the party at a later stage, two things will happen. One is you need to look at Section 21 Limitation Act, because the suit will commence as against that party only on the date on which the amendment is allowed and he is made a party. So if, for example, you wake up after 12 years and file an amendment application, then it's too late. The suit will already be time barred against the newly added party. The second aspect is Privy Council has and the various high courts have repeatedly held that where a party applies for amendment belatedly, the court should always impose costs. And sometimes the costs will be quite heavy. So when you say that, you know, can the plaintiff be charged with a fine? Yes, they will be imposed heavy costs if you apply belatedly.
This is the last question we'll be taking. Rajesh Kumar Kumantam, whether the probate case is barred by Section 137 of the Limitation Act?
I think this, the Honorable Supreme Court has now held that 137 does apply. It's recent. It came last year only. Earlier there were two views. In fact, Madras High Court held that there is no limitation at all for applications for probate. But now Honorable Supreme Court has said that, I think this is Sanjay Kishan call, said that 137 will apply and it will apply from the date of knowledge.
Okay. And K. Sankaran has referred that this judgment is of 1956, Hyderabad 133.
Okay. I think Mr. Shankar...
he has gone back to the traces of the route.
Nothing wrong in that. If it was Madras High Court, I might remember, but you have too good an opinion about me. I will have to read it and correspond with you separately about this.
Probably after we had reflected that you are a gold medalist, his presumption is also right.
I think that it's too much gold. 1956.
No, it's quite understandable. One invariably goes by the Supreme Court and the judgments of the High Court where one is practicing. because we all know that the judgment is binding and the other is pervasive. So one tends to read and focus more there too of the High Court. So this question, this person is time and again asking you, what is the easy way to remember CPC orders, sections and rules so that one could proceed further?
Take class from Vikas?
No, I would always believe that whatever we have gathered during all these webinars is that you have to study and study more. That is the only key, according to me.
There's nothing but reading. Just keep reading. I mean, yeah, there's not much to say.
Because the more you read, I was told by my guru that whenever you read, it gets incorporated here or here and you do not remember it. But once the client discusses you will suddenly remember that this question was somewhere and you are able to trace it out and suddenly you will remember it.
Absolutely.
That's what the thing I've learned. At least if you agree on that, then I agree that what we say normally in the court that at least on some points we are agreeing not to disagree and to move forward.
Correct.
So thank you, Mr. Srinath. It was a wonderful session, short, crisp, and the way we can always look forward. And those who have been connected with us can join us tomorrow at 4 p.m. We are having Justice V. Ramkumar. Those who have been following him up on different webinars, you would be finding that his insights on the criminal law is tremendous. And on live law and as well as on our YouTube channel of Beyond Law CLC and invariably on different platforms. As all the webinars have doing exceptionally well because he explains in a very illustrative manner. And tomorrow is a topic which for a young lawyer or any professional dealing on the criminal law would help him to further. He will be giving us insights on regular bail, drafting of the bail and cancellation of bail, which quite is fundamental, but giving the insights from a person who has so much knowledge would always be insightful. So do stay connected with us. Subscribe, share and like our YouTube channel. And you can also like us on the Facebook so that you get the updates. And our mobile number is already posted where we will be posting the judgments which will be shared by Mr. Srinath today on the WhatsApp group. So everyone stay blessed, stay happy. And again, I would thank Mr. Srinath, despite the fact that he was quite back-to-back packed with professional commitments. But I told him, he said that if it could be rescheduled, I said that we have all shared the thing. He was kind enough to reschedule that. And that's the way I was just reminded as the same cricket, you have to adjust as to what type of order you have to do. I requested him, he exceeded it. He's rescheduled the entire program, despite his heavy schedule. He has exceeded and shared his knowledge. Thank you, Srinath, again. And everyone stay safe, stay blessed. Namaskar.
Thank you.